Mr. President, I rise on the floor today with a simple message. We should completely dispel with the fiction that the American Bar Association is a fair and impartial arbiter of facts. This is a sad reality, but it is the reality. Let's back up. We in this body have taken an oath to uphold and defend the Constitution of the United States. Considering judicial nominees who have lifetime appointments is the most important thing that this Senate will do over the weeks ahead. It demands the full attention of every single member, Republican, Democrat, and Independent. This ought to be an opportunity for this body to pause and stand back from the frenzy of day-to-day media cycles and cable news shouting and recommit ourselves to basic American civics and to some very basic American ideas. The idea that our three branches of government have three separate roles. The idea that we in the Article I branch, the lawmakers, make the laws because we stand before the people and can be hired and fired. If the people are going to be in charge in our system, they need to be able to fire the people who make the laws. The idea that judges are explicitly not to make laws. The idea that judges do not have R and D, Republican and Democrat, behind their names, but rather that judges should be fairly and dispassionately ruling on the law and the facts. And the idea that all of us, temporary public servants, although the judiciary has their lifetime appointments, have the calling to be upholding and defending a system of limited government, again, through our three differentiated roles. Unfortunately, over the last few days in this body, it's become clear that some of us are tempted to outsource our constitutional duties to an outside organization. That organization, the American Bar Association, purports to be a neutral arbiter, but is frankly twisting its ratings process to drive a political agenda in an important nomination pending before this body. I'm referring specifically to the smear campaign of the ABA against Steve Graz, a qualified public servant who's been nominated by the president to the Eighth Circuit Court of Appeals. Steve Graz has decades of honorable service in Nebraska, including more than a decade as the chief deputy attorney general of my state. Mr. Graz is in fact eminently qualified for the circuit court bench, as has been testified to by Republicans and Democrats across our state. But let's set the scene first for the ABA's silly decision earlier this week to announce that they regard Steve Graz as not qualified. I'll highlight three specific items. First, we should discuss the two people who interviewed Mr. Graz and recognize that unfortunately, they are blatant partisans with a sad track record of hackery. Second, the ABA is trying to paint Mr. Graz as an extremist simply because he did his job as the Chief Deputy Attorney General of Nebraska and defended Nebraskans and Nebraska laws that wanted to outlaw the most barbaric of abortion practices, partial birth abortion. Third, we should talk about the obvious bigotry of cultural liberals evident in their interview process of Mr. Graz when they asked him repeated questions about non-legal matters that had nothing to do with the claims of competence of the ABA. First, let's talk about the two reviewers. The lead reviewer for the Bar Association on the Graz nomination was Arkansas law professor Cynthia Nance. As it turns out, this is an encore performance from Ms. Nance, for in 2006, she opposed then nominee and now Supreme Court Justice Samuel Alito because of his, quote, pro-life agenda, and she argued that made him unqualified to sit on the US Supreme Court. I wonder if there is anyone in this body who rejected her view then and voted to confirm now Justice Alito, who would now somehow echo her claims that Justice Alito is not qualified to sit in the seat that he now holds. Hopefully we as a body are better than that. The ABA's second reviewer, Lawrence Pulgrim, is an attorney from San Francisco. A cursory glance at Mr. Pulgrim's political involvement shows a long track record of support for left-wing candidates and aggressively progressive political organizations. These are the reviewers who are setting themselves up as dispassionate umpires calling balls and strikes. It's hogwash. These are not umpires. These are folks in the starting lineup of the ABA, an organization that explicitly endorsed pro-abortion policies beginning two decades ago. To be clear, there is nothing wrong with Nance and Pulgrim's zealous advocacy. They enjoy First Amendment rights just like all 320 million Americans do. There is nothing wrong with advocacy. What's wrong here is advocacy disguised as objective analysis. And that's what's actually happening in the case of the Graz nomination. This brings us to our second point about the ABA's treatment of Mr. Graz. When you read their letter, it makes many anonymous claims that some people supposedly support the author's great worry about Graz's alleged deeply held social views. But the closest thing the ABA ever comes to stating a fact, let alone producing a smoking gun, is the fact that as the Chief Deputy Attorney General of the state of Nebraska, Mr. Graz did the job of the Chief Deputy Attorney General of the state of Nebraska. That's not news. Mr. President, it is no secret that the vast majority of Nebraskans are pro-life, and thus it is no surprise that our state's laws reflect this. In the 1990s, Nebraska outlawed the most horrifying of all abortion procedures, the partial birth abortion. And lest anyone seek comfort behind empty euphemisms like choice, let's be very clear what the people of Nebraska were outlawing. The people of my state banned a gruesome and grotesque practice where a doctor partially delivers an unborn baby, and while that baby girl's head is the only thing still in the mother's womb, the doctor would then collapse the baby's skull. If there's anyone in this body who believes that that's a good and a moral act, that it's a good and a moral thing to deliver that baby girl, and then moments before her complete and full entry into the world, to vacuum out her brains, please come to the floor. Because few people believe that that is a good or a moral or a just act, or at least few would admit it openly. In fact, that's why just a few years later, federal law followed Nebraska's law and outlawed partial birth abortion. But in the 1990s, when Nebraska first outlawed that partial birth abortion procedure, many pro-abortion advocates brought suit, and Steve, as Chief Deputy Attorney General of Nebraska, defended the law of our state, which again is now the federal law. He defended that law because it was his job. He defended the law because that's what the people of Nebraska wanted when they said that this unspeakably barbaric procedure had no place in our state, and now, thankfully, has no place in our nation. Anyone who would paint Steve as an extremist needs to take a long, hard, and honest look at what he did as Chief Deputy Attorney General of Nebraska, defending the laws of the state of Nebraska. Third, I know that the ABA has an august-sounding name, but here's the reality of the kinds of stuff they did in their interview with Mr. Graz. They asked him, what kind of schools do your kids go to? Don't really understand the connection to their legal interview. And when they found out that his kids attended a religious institution, they asked him why his kids would go to a religious institution. Well, it turns out in my state, lots and lots of Lutherans and Catholics and lots of non-Lutherans and Catholics send their kids to Lutheran and Catholic schools. I don't know what that has to do with someone's competence, man or woman, to sit as an objective judge on a court of appeals. And yet the interviewers decided they should go there. Then they began to refer to Mr. Graz repeatedly in the interview as you people. They would frame questions to him and ask about you people. At one point, he finally paused and said, can you tell me who you people are? Because at this point, he didn't know if it was pro-life people, people who send their kids to religious schools, maybe just Nebraskans. They informed him that they were using the term you people to mean conservatives or Republicans. Third, in the course of their time with Mr. Graz, their interview went from actual legal questions to just asking him more and more detail about his pro-life views. Again, that have nothing to do with the distinction between sitting on the bench as someone who applies facts and law and someone who, in a private capacity or in his public capacity as the Chief Deputy Attorney General of Nebraska, had been defending the laws of the state of Nebraska. Ed Whalen is the president of the Ethics and Public Policy Center and is a legal and jurisprudential expert, and he's been covering the ABA case and their judgment on Mr. Graz this week closely. And so I'd like to read a few of his comments into the record. Quote, "The ABA contends that Graz is not sufficiently able to differentiate between the roles of advocate and adjudicator. And as its first example, the ABA contends that there is an inconsistency between Graz's stated respect for stare decisis, that is binding precedent, and the views that he expressed in a 1999 Law Review article, and that the ABA says he continues to adhere to. Selectively quoting this Graz article, the ABA faults him for his supposed, quote, suggestion that a lower court judge was entitled in deciding the issue, that is, whether a partially born fetus has a right to life under the 14th Amendment, to question the jurisprudence of a superior court. But the Law Review article that the ABA is criticizing, in that same article, Graz states on pages 27 and 28, quote, lower federal courts are obliged to follow clear legal precedents regardless of whether it may seem unwise or even morally repugnant to do so. However, a court need not extend questionable jurisprudence into new areas or supply it in areas outside of where there is a clear precedent. Read together, these sentences set forth an uncontroversial position. In order to create the controversy, however, the ABA entirely omits the first sentence, and it then pretends that the second sentence, rather than setting forth a general proposition, is, quote, referring to the Supreme Court's rulings in Roe and Casey, close quote. Yes, Graz applies that general proposition to the question whether Roe v. Wade and Planned Parenthood versus Casey speak to the legal status of a partially born human being, but as much as the ABA would have their reader think otherwise, he isn't concocting any special rule for abortion precedents. Skipping ahead, the ABA states that members, quote, of the bar shared instances in which Mr. Graz's conduct was gratuitously rude, close quote. Amazingly, it does not bother to give a single example of rude conduct by Graz, so its claim is entirely impossible to address. As an aside, this is again quoting Whalen, according to Larry Tribe, as Josh Blackman reminds us, Sonia Sotomayor had a reputation for being something of a bully when she was nominated to the Supreme Court. It was Whalen, by the way, who uncovered and published Tribe's letter to President Obama on this matter. The ABA alleges that there was a certain amount of caginess and at times a lack of disclosure on Graz's part with respect to some of the issues which the evaluators unearthed. But again, it provides no specifics and no illustrations, so it's impossible to assess whether Graz can be fairly faulted here. Something very fishy is going on. And here, pulling up from Whalen, I would comment that my senior senator, Deb Fischer, and I from Nebraska, both of whom were advising President Trump on the selection of Steve Graz for this Eighth Circuit vacancy, received literally boxes of letters from Nebraska lawyers, both Republican and Democrat, for months in the moment after the Eighth Circuit vacancy appeared. And at no point did we hear either verbally from people that we know in the state or in our interview process or in those boxes of letters, at no point did we hear of any rudeness on the part of Mr. Graz. And yet the ABA is judging him not qualified for the bench based on anonymous sources that say he's rude without a single example. There's not one example. It's an embarrassing letter from the ABA. Folks in this body who would be tempted to take the ABA's judgment seriously should read the letter. It's filled with anonymous claims that once he was rude to someone, and they have no examples. Back to Ed Whalen. Reviewer Nance's strong ideological bias is not difficult to uncover. Among other things, she signed a letter opposing the confirmation of Justice Alito. Given the ABA's persistent complaints about Graz's supposed inability to separate his judging from his, quote, pro-life agenda, close quote, it's notable that letter against Alito complains about the impact that he would have on women's reproductive rights. Nance also signed a letter arguing that the government's interests in protecting women's health and reproductive freedom and combating gender discrimination meant that even religiously affiliated organizations like Little Sisters of the Poor should be required to provide contraceptive coverage, including drugs and devices that can also operate in an abortive patient manner, notwithstanding their own religiously informed views on what constitutes illicit moral complicity in evil. Nance's very active Twitter feed, more than 28,000 tweets, also offers some revealing insights. Among other things, Nance retweeted the question whether Justice Scalia would have been in the majority in Dred Scott. And she evidently found amusing or insightful the observation that, quote, constitutional strict constructionists want women to have all the rights that they had in 1787, close quote. Yet this is just the sort of fine and balanced legal mind with its great grasp of conservative judicial principles that the ABA has put in charge of evaluating judicial nominees. And finally, the ABA's supposed check against a hostile lead investigator is to have a second investigator conduct a supplemental evaluation of the nominee in those instances in which the lead investigator has recommended a not qualified rating. So if you're the head of this committee, whom would you select to ensure that ideological bias has not warped your process? Probably not a very liberal activist lawyer from San Francisco, but that's exactly what the ABA did in this case. Lawrence Polgram, the second investigator, is a member of the left-wing Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights of the San Francisco Bay Area. Close quote. Mr. President, we have a crisis of institutional trust in this country that should concern all of us. Our job here in seeking to preserve and protect and uphold the Constitution and a Constitution that's focused on limited government is because our founders believed that the vast majority of the most interesting questions in life happen in the private sector, not just for-profit entities, but primarily civil society, families and neighborhoods and not-for-profit organizations and religious institutions and the Rotary Club and philanthropies and voluntary enterprises. The most interesting things in life are not in government. Government provides a framework for ordered liberty, but once you have that framework, once you're free from violence, you're free to live your life in all of these fully human, thick community ways in your local community. Our job in this body is to not only pass good legislation and repeal bad legislation, and to advise and consent on the president's nominees to faithfully execute the laws that have been passed by the Article I branch. But our job is also to speak to a constitutional system where a separation of powers exists so that power is not consolidated in Washington and so that there's room for the full flowering of social community across our great land. And so the decline of trust in our institutions is something that should trouble all of us. Our job here isn't merely about government, but it's also teaching our kids about the Constitution and about basic civics. And so I ache when private sector institutions and when civil society institutions see the trust in those institutions decline. But one of the things that's clearly happening in our time is that the ABA is becoming much less a serious organization and much more an activist organization advancing a specific political agenda. I would hope the ABA is due to appear before the Judiciary Committee in 2 weeks to explain this interview process and why they gave this judgment on Mr. Graz with so few facts and so little evidence and so much pro-abortion zealotry driving the opinion of the lead reviewer in this case. I would hope that when the ABA comes before the Judiciary Committee, it recants of this very silly opinion of not qualified, of a man who is eminently qualified and is going to serve very well the people of not just the Eighth Circuit, but this country on the Circuit Court of Appeals. I would hope that the ABA would recant this silly judgment. But if they do not, I think we should recognize that the fiction of the ABA as a serious organization that ought to be taken seriously as a neutral, impartial arbiter of qualifications for the federal bench should be dispensed with. And we in this body who've actually taken an oath to three separate but equal branches with differentiated roles of legislating, executing, and ultimately judging, would continue to affirm that distinction, and that we should want judges who do not try to be super legislators, but rather seek to attend themselves to the facts and the law, as is indeed the calling of Article III branch judges. Thank you, Mr. President.